Good morning, Graad 10. Goeiemôre Graad 10. Welkom by die Graad 10 eerste addisionele taal webinar vanoggend. Ek gaan net nog so 2 minute gee vir almal om in te skakel by ons. I'm just going to allow 2 more minutes for everyone to join and then we'll get started. I just want to show you today we're going to do the debrief deur Pieter Strauss. You can get your study guides ready on page 164 if you would like to follow. Then I'll see you shortly. Good morning, Grade 10s. I see that some of you say that you're experiencing problems with the sound. Can I just ask you, if you are able to hear me, just put up your hand, please. I hope that most of you know where to do that. Okay, so it's not a problem that everyone is experiencing. I'm very glad to hear that. I just want to see more or less how many of you are able to hear me. Okay, because I'm also experiencing a problem with my sound. I can't hear you guys or the organizer in the background, but she can hear me perfectly. So I was worried that it might be a problem for everyone, but it seems fine. Okay, I see that they are saying that it's working. Okay, let's get started. Good morning, Grade 10s, and welcome to the Afrikaans Eat webinar this morning. Today we are going to do the short story, die kortverhaal, debrief, deur Pieter Strauss. It is on page 164 in your study guide. If you have your study guide with you, I would recommend that you open it on that page, then you can follow as I'm reading. Then you can also hear how I pronounce the words and it makes it easier if I read and you follow. Okay, just firstly want to go through the the basics like we always do. Okay, if you're struggling to hear me, make sure that your audio is turned on and your speaker volume is turned up. You will automatically be muted when joining the session. That is because we don't want to hear everyone's background noises. Should you have any questions, you can ask your questions in the question box below. Please post your questions as we move along. Then after the session or after I've done my presentation, I'll go to the questions and I'll answer them for you. If I don't get to all the questions, don't be worried. I do get a nice summary of all the questions I did not get to at the end of the session that I answer, and then it is sent to you. Okay, I hope that most of you know where you have to click to raise the hand. Let's do it again. Let's do it again so I can see maybe there's more of you listening to me now or who's able to hear me. Just put up your hands again. Oh, yeah, it's much better. I think we also waited for a few people. Okay. Okay, you can download this presentation in the handout box. The handout box is just below that raise your hand box. So you can download this presentation there. Attendees are encouraged to ask questions and leave comments. I don't allow you to ask questions. I found that it wastes a lot of time because some people accidentally raise their hand and then I unmute you and then you just for you to explain that it was an accident, you didn't mean to raise your hand. So I read the questions afterwards for everyone to hear and I answer them for everyone to hear. Well, we will have to do it like that today since I can't hear you this morning. Okay. If we did not get to your question, please send an email to academics@impact. If after the session you realize that there was something you wanted to ask and you forgot, or you didn't have time to ask, please send that email to academics@impact. And then the questions in the question box will be made available afterwards. For you to see this entire presentation, please join our Impact YouTube channel. All our webinar sessions are recorded. Okay. Then I hope that you are all ready. I left this here for you. Some of you that joined my previous webinars would know that I gave you a little summary of stuff that you need to look for when you are doing a short story. I'm going to leave it here for you because I don't want you to have to go back and try to remember where did I mention this. So every time we do a short story, I'm going to leave it there for you so that when you download it and you do a printout or I don't know how you prefer using these notes, you have everything together. Okay, I'm just going to run through them also. So you look at the title of the story, this will already give you some kind of idea of what the story will be about. The content is what the story is about. And then the characters, you will have to, most of the time they ask you to give the characteristics of someone in a story. Okay. Make sure that you are able to identify the main character, the hoofkarakter. Okay, dan die bou van die verhaal, that is the structure. You have a begin, a cause and a conclusion, die begin, verloop en slot. Dan innerlijke en uiterlijke conflict. Remember that uiterlijke conflict, external conflict is conflict that we can see happening. It's a physical or verbal fight. Okay, die vertellers is the speakers. Jy krijg een ek-verteller en een alomteenwoordige verteller. Die ek-verteller, I want you to look out for words like ek, my. That will really tell you that it's an ek-verteller. En een alomteenwoordige verteller would use the words like hy, het syne, I say, there's a list in the short story, I'll show it to you when we get there. Dan sewe die ruimte, that is the setting, when and where. You will see that there will be clues in the short story to say where this whole thing is playing. Die keerpunt, that is the turning point in the story. It's also called the climax of the story, of the climax in Afrikaans. Dan nege is die thema. That is the main idea, the lesson of the story. Okay. Then I'm going to read this to you. I want you, if you want to, in your book, as I'm reading, please try and make notes to make it easier for yourself. But if you feel like you might stop listening to me while making notes, then don't. Okay. Just want to check. Okay. Okay, guys, I hope you're ready. I'm going to read this to you now. So you can just be very calm, listen or make notes as I'm reading. Okay. Die brief deur Pieter Strauss. Die boordwisser woer woer deur die lig. Dit tref die seun wap teen sy regter skouer. Sy mond gaan woordeloos oop en weer toe, soos 'n vloedwatervis in die leë geloopte vlei. Al met sy armsenuwees langs, priem 'n pyn tot in sy vingerpunte, terwyl fyn kruidstof om hom styf. Die hele klas draai om en gaap hom aan. Pieter Bitter Bollard, gil juffrou Hoefnagel van voor in die klas. Wat het ek gister vir jou gevra om te doen, hè? Jy moet hierdie boek oortrek en slegs die eerste oefening daarin doen. Jy moes dit doen en nie jou ouers nie. Een oefening, nie die hele boek nie. Wat dink jy moet ek die res van die jaar met jou aanvang, hè? Of weet jy die heel jaar, of gaan jy die heel jaar net by die venster bly uitstaar, soos wat jy die afgelope 10 minute sit en doen? Sy glier hom aan. Bly aan die einde van die periode agter. Ek wil nie verder met jou sukkel nie. Hierdie saakie sal ek per brief onder jou ouers se aandag bring. En maandag bring jy daardie brief vir my terug, geteken. Hoor, ek wil dit bitter graag in jou leer plaas. Vir toekomstige verwysing. Jou tipe raak mos al slegter hoe ouer hulle word. Aan die einde van die skooldag stap Pieter huis toe. Sy tas druk teen sy seer regter sleutelbeen. 'n Wit koevert steek uit sy hemp se sak. Hy is nog net 3 weke in die nuwe skool en is al klaar in die moeilikheid. Maar ai, die boek se woordsomme was gisteraand so lekker om te doen. Hy kon dit eenvoudig nie meer sit neergesit kry nie. En dis mos in potlood gedoen. Hy kan dit mos later weer uitvee. Hy hoor hoe die ander kinders lag en gesels oor wat hulle die naweek gaan doen. Ag, as hy maar so kon lag. Vir hom beteken huis toe gaan tyd nie noodwendig vryheid nie. Sy pa is 'n kontrakwerker by die Shishin Saldanha spoortraject. Hy help om die spore te lê. En soos hy die spoor lê, moet hy en sy ma saampikkel. Van die een dorp en skool na die ander. Skielik grits fietswiele agter hom op die grys. Grys is those grey, little grey rocks that you find at a train station or next to a railroad. Hy draai om. Dis Gert Momberg, 'n klasmaat. Haai ou Piet Bitterboela, groet Gert en lag. Loop jy lekker? Dit lyk vir my juffrou Hoefnagel het die verkeerde job gekies. Dalk moes sy eerder 'n jukskei speler geword het, of wat dink jy? Pieter glimlag vir 'n oomblik van 'n stukkie sonskyn oor die donkerte in sy gemoed. Ja, nee, sê hy. Gooi kan sy so waar as wragtig. Ek is net jammer dit was nie 'n kopskoot nie. Dan kon ek 'n paar dae in die hospitaal gaan lê het. Of dalk sommer in die begraafplaas. Gert wip op en af op sy fiets se skokbrekers, soos hy lag. Skokbrekers is the shocks of the bike. Sy pa is die dorp se dokter en hy ry glo elke paar maande op 'n ander fiets. Wat doen jy vanmiddag? Vra hy. Kan ek by jou kom kuier? Pieter se hart klop in sy keel. Nee. Ek sal eerder later by jou kom kuier as ek mag. Pieter maak die opslaan huisie se voordeur oop en stap in. Hy sit sy tas in sy kamer neer en stap die gang af waar hy 'n gewerskaf in die kombuis hoor. Gewerskaf is he heard someone is busy doing something in the kitchen. Sy ma is besig om kos te kook. Voor hy kan groet, fluister sy: "Gaan trek jou skoolklere uit my kind, onmiddellik. Jou pa is hier." Die bekende lamgevoel kom lê oor sy bors. Druk sy keel stywer toe. Ma, wat eet ons vandag? Ek is honger. Hier is verdomp nooit iets lekker om te eet in hierdie huis nie. Hy wil nie met sy ma lelik wees nie, maar hy sukkel deesdae om sy woede en frustrasies in toom te hou, ook by die skool. Met wie die hel dink jy praat jy, meneertjie? Groet jy nie jou pa nie? Brul dit skielik vanuit die gang deur. Middag, pa, groet hy so in die omswaai. Ek is jammer as die woorde verkeerd uitgekom het, maar ek is verskriklik honger. Hoewel hy dit van hier nog nie kan ruik nie, weet hy sy pa se asem ruik weer soos 'n bierbrouwery en dat hy vandag bitter mooi in sy spore sal moet trap. As hy pa teen die tyd op 'n Vrydagmiddag reeds so gekoring is, gekoring meaning drunk, dat hy sy hakkelry probeer naaap, dan lê daar vir hom en sy ma swaarigheid die naweek voor. En die brief, onthou hy, dit ook nog. En maandag wil juffrou Hoefnagel dit terug hê, geteken. Hy besluit om dit so gou as moontlik agter die rug te kry. Hy wag tot sy pa die volgende bier klaar geskink en daarmee op die rusbank gaan neerplons het. Hy haal die koevert uit sy hempsak en hou dit bewend uit na hom. Sal pa asseblief hierdie brief teken, vra hy. Dit is van juffrou Hoefnagel, ons wiskunde juffrou. Waar is die brief, Pieter Bollard? Vra die onderwyseres toe hulle maandag in die klas, toe hy die klas binnestap. Seker by die huis vergeet. Pieter sit sy tas langs sy bank neer, maak dit oop, vroedel daarin rond en kom met die wit koevert na die onderwyseres toe aangestap. En waar kom daai blou oog vandaan, Pieter? Vra sy. Het jy weer die naweek van die dorpskinders probeer boelie? Of dalk gaan ronddank tussen die ander spoortraject skollies van die onderdorp? Ek het geval, juffrou, antwoord hy en kyk na sy regterskoen se nerf afpunt. Sy kry sy hand met die brief daarin aan die polsbeen. Sy kyk na die ronde bruin kring op haar eens skoon koevert. Sy trek hom nader tot byna teen haar geplooide mond. In sy oor fluister sy sodat net hy kan hoor. Weet jy, ou Pieter Bollard, die wêreld sal darem 'n veel beter plek gewees het sonder skollies soos jy. Toe laat sy die remmende lyf los. Neem toe die toegeplakte koevert en skeer dit in fyn stukkies op. Met 'n strak gesig stap sy na die snippermandjie in die hoek. Snippermandjie is 'n dustbin. In die hoek en maak dan haar vuis stadig oop. Stom, soos doodgerypte vlinders in die verkeerde seisoen, stort dit uit haar hand. Okay. Just quickly show me your hands, please. Okay, I'm glad to see most of you are still with me. Okay. Okay, guys. This is quite an upsetting short story. I don't know about you, but I was quite upset after reading this the first time. I hope that you understand that what the story is about. Okay. It is about Pieter, who lives in a town with his mum and his dad. His dad works on the railways. Hy lê die spore. I'll figure out how to say that in English later. And he has a math teacher that is quite a bully. And his dad is probably an alcoholic that beats them. I'm just seeing some of your questions. I just want to explain some of the words to you that you might have found a bit hard. A bored visser, you would see that is in the first sentence of the short story. A bored visser is a blackboard dasker. So the teacher threw him with that. Then it says that I was a vloed water vis in a leeggeloopte vlei. That is a jolly. Directly translated, there is a flat water fish in a small lake that has run dry. A vis wat deur 'n stroom water in die vlei ingeswem het, maar nou is die vlei 'n kleinerige meer sonder water. Prem is a piercing pain. You would remember that it said that he, when she threw him with that board, he could feel the pain that it geprem. Then stijf, that is like dust in the air. You would remember it's a brown. You could almost see the dust coming towards you sometimes when it is a dry season and the wind and it's quite windy. So she threw him so hard with that blackboard dust that it looked like that around him. It was probably white chalk everywhere. Okay, dan sy regte sleutelbeen, that is his right collarbone. So that is where she threw the blackboard dust at. Dan die Shishin Saldanha spoor traject, that is the railroad track. That is the project that his dad worked on. There's just some information regarding that from the years, and you can, at the Viscus, you can just read that. Then some people drag them along. In Afrikaans, when someone, especially with young kids, if they hear that someone's going to drive somewhere, they are immediately ready to go. And then your mom would say, "Hoekom moet jy altyd saam pikkel?" It means, why do you always have to drag, come along when we're going somewhere? Just want to move this camera a bit because it's blocking my view. Dan jikskyspeler, that is just the player of the game, jikskyp. Dan swarigheid. Sorry, I just want to move this around. Swarigheid, to have doubts about. That means when he says that he foresees that they might experience some swarigheid this weekend, after seeing that his dad is already drunk at that time of that time on a Friday, that means that he is predicting that him and his mom will experience some difficulty. They might have a very hard weekend if the dad is already drunk at this time. Okay, dan neerplonst, it is to come down with a plunge, that is like someone would go and plunge onto a couch after a long day. Dan niks nik, that is a good for nothing. And dan remmende, that means if you are resisting. It says that the teacher finally let go of his remmende body, that means his resisting body. So he was trying to free himself from her grip when she grabbed him on the wrist. Then I hope that you've got that part. Remember, after that weekend on the Monday when she asked him for the letter and he brought it to her, he handed her the letter and she grabbed him on the wrist. And then she whispered in his ear that the world would have been a much better place without schoolies, that means bad people like him, the poor people working on the trains. Okay. So now let's quickly discuss. The title is the brief, that means the letter. This refers to the letter that the teacher gave Pieter for his parents to sign to speak about his terrible behavior, which we know was not terrible. She assumed that his parents did his homework or did all the activities in his math book, but it was actually him. He said that he liked it so much that he couldn't put his book down. So she just assumed that his parents did it, and she's irritated with him because she doesn't know what she's going to do with him for the rest of the year because he's now done all the work for the year. Okay, and this letter is also the reason for the dad's physical abuse towards Pieter. And the teacher uses this letter to show her authority, and she's a bit of a bully as well. We saw that very early in this short story. Just want to check the time. Okay, then the inhoud. So remember, if we ask you about the inhoud, the content, you just have to give me a summary of what the story is about. So jy gaan nou sê, die kort verhaal gaan oor Pieter, wat in die moeilikheid is by juffrou Hoefnagel, sy wiskundeonderwyser. Sy is kwaad omdat hy al sy werk vir die jaar gedoen het en omdat sy dink sy ouers dit vir hom gedoen het. Sy sê dat hy 'n brief vir sy ouers moet gee om te teken. Toe hy die middag by die huis kom, is sy pa reeds besig om bier te drink en is gekoring. Remember, hy sê gekoring means he is already drunk. Hy vertel sy pa van die brief en sy pa gee vir hom 'n blou oog. Toe hy maandag die brief vir sy juffrou of vir juffrou Hoefnagel gee, Skeer sy dit op en gooi dit weg sonder om eers daarna te kyk. So you will see in the last paragraph, it said that she took the unopened letter and she tore it to pieces and then she threw it in the dustbin. That means that this letter that was so important and that Peter got a beating over, she did not even have a look, she didn't even open it. That just shows you the bully mentality that she has. Dan die karakters, the characters. Juffrou Hoefnagel, she insults him by saying that people like him only gets worse over time. She is physically abusive because she throws him with a blackboard duster and she grabs him hard on the wrist. She's just interested in her own opinion. She didn't ask him why did he do all the work. If he did it himself, she just assumed that he doesn't listen to her, he does whatever he wants, and he asked his parents to do the work for him. And she's a bully, and she's probably not a very good teacher as well, because instead of being proud of him and seeing his potential, and him being able to do all of this work, she now is irritated because what does he think she must now do with him for the rest of the year? So it's an inconvenience because now she might have to do extra work and to keep him busy. So she's not a very good teacher as well. And then Peter Bollard, I hope I'm pronouncing that surname correctly. He is the main character of this story. What do we know about him? We know that he likes school and he loves the woordsomme that he does in math. I want you to think about this. Now that we know what it's like in his house, that he has an abusive dad, it could be that these math problems that he solves and that he enjoys so much might take his mind off his circumstances at home. So it might be an escape for him from his circumstances, and that's why he likes it so much. Okay. We know that they move a lot for his dad's work and that he doesn't like moving that often. He probably is very well-mannered and he shows respect to people or to any authoritative figure because he doesn't stand up for himself. So she screams at him and she insults him and she assumes that he didn't, but he never corrects her. He never says to her that it wasn't me. He keeps quiet. That could also be because of how his dad treats them at home. Okay. And he's shy. He's shy of where he lives and he's probably shy of his dad. Because when his friend, Gert Momberg, you will remember that's the classmate that came up to him with a bike. And we know that Gert Momberg's dad is the doctor in the town. So they are probably very rich. And when he asked to come visit Peter at his house, Peter says, no, I'd rather come visit you at your house. So he's probably ashamed of the way they live because they are poor and because of his dad, because he knows it's Friday and his dad is probably drinking. Okay, then Gert Momberg, what do we know about Gert? We know that he's a classmate of Peter's. We know that his dad is a doctor and that they have a lot of money. We know this because it says there that he gets a new bike every few months. So that shows that they have a lot of money. But still, Gert Momberg seems like a good, nice, friendly child. And you would think that he might be spoiled and also a bit of a bully. He is actually not. He's actually very friendly towards Peter. And he sympathizes with Peter that Juffrou Hoefnagel is so mean to him. And they joke about it and he's making him feel a bit better about it. Okay, he wants to go visit Peter at his house, but Peter says, no, I'd rather come visit at yours. Okay, then Peter Chappell, what do we know about his father? We know that he does contract work at the railway. We know that he's probably an alcoholic. And we know that his family is scared of him, especially when he drinks. We know that. How do we know that? We know that because his mum whispered to Peter, saying that I think you need to go get out of your school clothes and do it quickly because your dad's home. So the fact that she's whispering means that she's scared of him. Okay, and it also says that Peter had a tight feeling on his chest when his mom said that, and his heart rate got, so it shows that he's scared of his dad. Okay, and we know that it is bad reason to be scared because he sent Peter home with a blue eye on the Monday. What do we know of Peter Samar, his mother? We know that she's scared of his dad. Because she whispered. That's about all we can say about his mom. Okay, dan die bou van die gedig, die begin, the start of, nie gedig nie, sorry, that needs to change up the story. The atmosphere word geskep. The atmosphere is created. We know, so it starts with him in the classroom and we is thrown with this word visit. And we also, at the start, we get to know the characters. We know what type of teacher and person Juffrou Hoefnagel is. We know what type of person Peter is that doesn't stand up for himself. So we get to know some of the characters quite early. Danny Verloop, the course of the story. The first thing that happens is a problem is created. The problem is that Peter, the teacher gives Peter a letter for his parents to sign. Okay, so this is now a problem because they are going to be mad at him or his dad at least. Okay, and then a tension is created. And the tension is created when we know that Peter gets home and his dad is there and his dad is drunk and we know that they are scared of his dad and his dad now has to sign this letter. So the tension is created because now we as a reader don't know how he's going to do this, when is he going to do this, what will his dad do when he reads the letter. Okay. Then the conclusion, that is where the tension is over. Okay, the tension is over, although very upsetting, the tension is over. Because Monday he gets home and the teacher said, why do you have a blue eye? Or black eye. I think in English you say black eye. So we know that he told his dad about the letter and we know that his dad beat him over it. But to that tension, we know what happened. Okay. And then we know that the teacher didn't even bother reading the letter. Okay, dan die konflik. The innerlike conflict, that is where Peter feels ashamed about his house and about the way his dad acts and that he drinks a lot. And then you would remember that Peter also made a joke with his class friend, saying that he wished that the teacher threw him in the head, then he could have been in hospital for a few days, or he could have been in the cemetery. So that means that he actually doesn't want to be in his circumstances anymore. Maybe he really don't want to be there. Maybe he really wants to be rather in a hospital or in a grave somewhere. Okay, so that is the conflict that he feels. And also he's being his teacher insults him and tells him that he's actually very low class and that the world would be a better place without him. Okay, then the uiterlijke conflict, that is the conflict that we can see Juffrou Hoefnagel thrusting with the chalkboard or the blackboard eraser, and his dad that gave him a blue eye, and Juffrou Hoefnagel that grabbed him on the arm or the wrist. Okay. Dan die bespreking, die verteller. You would see that they use the words sy en hy, therefore it's a alomteenwoordige verteller. Right? Dan die ruimte, die kortverhaal speel by die skool af. This takes place at the school. We know this because words like bordwisser, juffrou en klas appears in the short story. And then also the second part or the middle part of the story happens at home. We know this because we see words like kamer and kombuis and they talk about a gang. Hi, Danny Kierpunt. The climax of the story is where Peter hands over the letter to, there can be two. The book says that is where he gives the letter to his teacher the Monday morning. It could be where he finally approached his dad. Fine. And then the theme of any gedachte, that is the lesson that you learn. It could be that either that all your good deeds and hard work will not always be appreciated by everyone, not everyone will always see your potential, and not all people and teachers are good people. Okay, guys, let's see the questions. I hope that this makes sense to you. I'm unable to translate the entire short story for you, but I hope you got the gist of it. I just want to open the question box here so I can see. Oh, guys, sorry. Okay, I just want to drag this open a bit. Sound. I see. I hope that your audio issues were sorted out. Lays train tracks. Oh, thank you. A track layer. Thank you. Sorry, guys, I just want to. You are very welcome. Someone is saying thank you that this helped. I hope that the fact that I try and translate as most as I can. So I hope it helps you. Yes, I agree with you. Vaisalya, do you think that another reason he likes those math problems is because those are the only problems that he can actually solve and not his home problems? Yes, I do agree with you. It could be that he likes because that's the only thing he has control over, problems that he can solve. And then you said, another thing, if we are asked to comment about his stuttering, it's so difficult to explain a stutter. I'll quickly tell you that I know a person that she stutters, but she is also an actress. On stage, she doesn't stutter once in an hour play that she does. So it could be that there's a mental reason for the stutter. Abuse, or it could be that it's a speech problem or a medical problem. It's so hard to determine why someone stutter. So I don't think they will ask you about the stutter unless they ask you your opinion, which you can then say whatever, as long as it makes sense. Okay. Well, this is not based on a true story, but this could happen. I think this happens quite often. And yes, you are right, this is a very sad story. I was also very sad about this. Okay, I just want to see. Okay, guys, I think that I've answered most of your questions. If there's something that you wanted to know and you want to ask me, please send a mail to academics. You will remember there in the intro that I did. I did give the email address there. I hope this helped you. And I want you to remember that they've now decided that you will not write a June exam. But IMPACT decided that it will be very good exercise for you to still write a June exam because it's a good preparation for your November exam. Please study and write the exam like you would under normal circumstances, because nerves I want you to be a bit nervous when you write the gen exam, because the way you react to questions and read questions when you are nervous makes a big difference. So I want you to write it like you would in a normal exam situation. And then when we discuss it in the webinar, I'm going to discuss those gen exams with you. When I discuss it with you, I want you to see the mistakes you make so you don't make those same mistakes in the November exam. Okay. You are going to write the June exam. It won't be for marks. You won't write it at a formal with formal invigilators. You are going to write it as revision. Now, you don't send those marks to Impact. We don't know how you do or well did you study. We don't know, but you're going to do it for exercise. Okay, for practice. Okay, guys, I hope that this helped you a lot. Enjoy the rest of your week, and then I'll see you again in 2 weeks. Keep well. Bye.